Mai arara te rangi i runga nei, mai arara te papa i raro nei, mai arara te kāhui ariki, te kāhui tipua, te kāhui tauira. Tuku ana, tuku ana. Tuku te reo kia rere, tuku te kupu kia taka, tuku te take kia mau ueha, ueha, ueha. Ueha nuku, ueha rangi, ueha tāne nui ārangi, tāne whakapiripiri. Nāna i tō ko te rangi ki runga nei kia tū hāhā. Kia tū ki ana rangi, tū ki ana nuku, ka tangi te hau, ka mātao, ka ao, ka awatea. He ao mārama, tihei, mauriora. Ka huri, ka huri, ka huri te ao. Ka ao, ka ao, ka ao mārama. Ka huri, ka pō, ka pō, ka ao. Mai ngā wai rarapā o te karu o te ika Māui, ka rere, ka pari, ko rua mahanga, te awa. I raro i te maru o te tāpere nui o whātonga, ko tōku horowai, ko ngā pai maunga o tara rua, ko ōku tapuai, ki rangi whako o mama. Ko kahurangi tēnei o tātou reo, o tātou kōrero, o tātou tāngata, ko Wairarapa. Mai hoki mai, ki kahurangi, our voices, our stories, our place. My name is Te Atahia, huri hanga nui no Ngāti Kahungunu ki Wairarapa, no rangi tāne hoki, kia ora mai rā tātou katoa. Oh, kua taumaha katoa, kua pauri katoa te wiki nei, no reira ko tēnei taku mihi aroha, aku mihi maioha ki ngā whānau pani. O tēnei nā motu, o tēnei nā kāinga o tātou. Ki ngā mate, haere, haere, haere atu rā. Kia tātou kua mahue nei, tēnā koutou. It's been a rough week for our community, and I just want to acknowledge our whānau pani, those who are mourning and in grief at this time. I also want to acknowledge the whānau kahurangi, māreikura, whatukura and rangatira who have been leading our whānau, our community, our friends through this time and sitting on our paepae and calling our karanga and providing kai and warmth and comfort. I know many of our whānau who haven't been experiencing death recently are experiencing the heaviness of a crazy, unexpected and ever-changing time in this COVID world. I acknowledge you all and the challenges that we are all facing as a collective. Today's program is really just a chance for me, Te Atahi on Kahurangi, to reconnect in with Arrow FM, our wonderful radio station here in the heart of Wairarapa and Whakaoriori, and to continue some of the conversations that are kind of up in the air at the moment because it's been so long. I have unfortunately been in isolation twice already this year and have just come out of my most recent COVID isolation period. So I do want to first apologise that I have had to get the show to play reruns and repeats of older shows in my absence, but it's such a wonderful feeling to be back here in the studio. And I'm looking forward to reconnecting in with you with some kōrero, with some pūrākau, and we've got some reo stuff to get through too. Now, the last time we chatted, we were in a different lunar calendar time and month, so very quickly let's put ourselves into the here and now. Ko tēnei te paraire te te kaumātoru o mei rua manorua te kaumārua. Ko te marama e ai ki ngā kōrero, te mātorohanga ko atua o haratua. So we've just come into our new lunar calendar month. So right now we're in the very end of the Māori season, and we call this time of the year haratua. Haratua, traditionally speaking, was a time that our tūpuna were well into their hibernation state, having harvested the end of their crops, stored them into whata and other storage facilities, containers, ways of keeping. And they're now kind of huddling together and reflecting and having wānanga and mātauranga shared and transferred from generation to generation. Now, in a modern sense, you can kind of understand this kind of incredible ritual ceremony of hibernating, of slowing down, because of course it's the coldest time of the year. We are well within Tuhine Takurua, we know this because the sun, while he might be out and providing us with light and a little bit of warmth, he's still far away. So we can often look up at the sky during a lovely day like today and actually look at the sun without it hurting our eyes, which means the sun is further away than he might be during our spring and summertime. He's very much cozy with Hine Takurua, his winter maiden, and therefore we have different stars in the sky giving us different information. Of course, we've just come out of Painga Whawha, which was our kumara harvesting, and Haratua is now our reflective time because we can no longer see Matariki and her 8 children. When I say that, to the naked eye, of course, you might be able to see them. The stars don't go anywhere, but of course the illusions allow us not to see it, because when we look at Matariki, and we would have been seeing her kind of descend, she's too close to the horizon. And so what that means is Te Waka o Rangi, Matariki is part of a much larger constellation. Matariki at one end, Te Tautoru, or the 3 stars of the belt of Orion, they've disappeared from view. Not the Orion stars, but Matariki, of course, because the waka is dipped, while Taramainuku, the tohunga of that waka, prepares his net to cast. And when he casts his net, ka whetūrangitia, ngā wairua. So our wairua that have been gathering and waiting to be collected with the collective, I te kupenga nui o Taramainuku, o te wakaorangi, they get sprinkled into the sky as stars, and that's part of the ceremony of Matariki, which we're all waiting for. So we expect the rise of Matariki to happen from about the 21st of June onwards. We've only got about a month to start planning for our first public holiday and commemoration and ceremonious time of Matariki, which is very, very exciting for Te Ao Māori. And that is a really key thing to be looking forward to, particularly at a time of grief, which I know some of us are going through. And so I wanted to bring in some kōrero from this wonderful book that I've referenced a number of times. I'm holding it up for those of you who will come and see this on the video online. Pūrākau, Māori Myths Retold by Māori Writers. Now, I don't like the subtitle, just saying. My personal opinion is Māori Histories Retold by Māori Writers, Kei Te Pai Tērā. But I had the privilege and honour to come along to the release of this book a couple of years ago as part of, I think it was the Wai Word Festival. I may need to be corrected on that, here at Aratoi Museum in Whakaoriori. And Whiti Hereaka had a sit down and a kōrero about this wonderful collection of short stories and poems by many of our famous Māori writers and poets. It's co-edited with Whiti Ihi Maira, and it has a very mindful balance of female, male and non-gendered perspective. And they're a collection of our most kind of important or most well-known, if you like, whakaaro, ideas, pūrākau, stories and hitori, histories in Te Ao Māori, but set into a modern context, into a contemporary context. So for those of us who struggle with connecting and with the spirituality or Te Ao Māori, let's say, perspective, for whatever reason, maybe because of our own belief systems, or maybe because there's a jar happening or a barrier between us and the learning. It's a really cool tool, this book, because it's placing a lot of the kōrero into the here and now so that it's easier to visualise or physicalise if that helps your learning process. So I'm just going to read some excerpts as we go through today's session, and weave those into my thought process today and some of the reo that we're going to be doing as well. Nō reira. From Pūrākau, Chapter 2, Rangi Nui and Papatūānuku. And the subtitle here is We Who Live in Darkness. Now, again, an amazing selection of some of our greats. This here is a poem, and it's written by the late great Hone Tuwhare. Now, I was introduced to this wonderful man and brilliant mind about... oh, I don't even want to give you the year, but during my teenagehood while I was at high school studying literature, and it was English lit, but with kind of content from Aotearoa, content that made up who we are uniquely as an identity, I suppose nationally speaking, but also quite personal for those of us who identify as Māori. And so Hone Tuwhare naturally was one of those wonderful minds that we would dissect, would look at his words and would kind of play around with, recreate, reenact, wānanga, question. And I loved it because he uses both Te Reo Māori and Te Reo Pākehā. He wasn't a fluent reo speaker, but also he was really good at capturing a huge or large or serious or heavy topic and making it accessible for those of us who, you know, I mean, I was a teenager at the time, those of us who may otherwise struggle with those concepts. He managed to really make them succinct and summarised in a way that was accessible for most of us. And what was amazing for me in my fifth form year, I believe that's year 11, my father had this incredible opportunity, those of you who know Hone Hurihanga Nui, to... be part of an album which celebrated Hone Tuwhare's poetry. And so each of the artists, and there were all sorts of artists on there, and many of us know the names, Don McGlashan and Golden Horse, etc., and they would choose a poem of Hone Tuwhare's, and they would change it or adapt it or re-enact it, if you wish, into a waiata. And so this lovely poem here I'm about to read is called We Who Live in Darkness. And I'm going to give it kīnaki, give it a condiment, by playing Dad's song from the Tuwhare album, just as a way of grounding myself into today's session, but also as a kind of connection point of acknowledgement of how connected Hone Tuwhare has been and has always and will always be to his people and to his culture. We Who Live in Darkness, by Hone Tuwhare. It had been a long, long time of it, wriggling and squirming in the swamp of night. And what was time anyway? Black intensities of black on black on black, feeding on itself. Something immense, immeasureless. No more. There just had to be a beginning somehow, for on reaching the top of a slow rise, suddenly, eyes I never knew I possessed were stung by it, forcing me to hide my face in the earth. It was light, my brothers, light. Most beautiful sight in filtered past, the armpit hairs of the father, why I could even see to count all the fingers of my hands held out to it, see the stain, the clutch of good earth on them. But then he moved, and darkness came down even more oppressively. It seemed, and I drew back tense. I drew back tense, angry. Brothers, let us kill him. Push him off. Ko papatua nuku ko te whenua. Ko papatua nuku tōku kaipō.
Papatua nuku, we are stroking, caressing the spine of the land. We are massaging the rigid back of the land. With thou's for forever loving feet, she loves it, squirming the larigold, yeah, in delight, we love her. For whatever loving feet, hell, she loves it, squirming the larigold, yeah, in delight, we love her.
Tēnā anō tātou katoa ku te atahia, tēnei mō kahurangi I Arrow FM, tēnei atau pareire, atua o haratua. So this current lunar phase that we're in, tātou mā, is one of quiet reflection as the energy heats up a little bit for our big moons, starting with Ohua between tonight and tomorrow. And the big moon period, as we've spoken about a number of times on our show for Maramataka readings, tells us or informs us that it's a really good time to be active and productive and out and about and connecting with others and going outwards. Now, we can do that, but in this interim period, it's very, very creative. Medium energy is a really nice time to kind of get your arty-farty juices flowing, to put some, maybe some goals together, some planning for the next month ahead, strategizing, making ideas into actions, that kind of stuff. So Atua is one of my favorite periods, and so too it's all who are new beginnings, new starts. And for those of us who have been feeling a little bit rough lately, I think we're all looking forward to that kind of symbolism in our natural world. Now, we are talking about Pūrākau, Kōrero, as we work through our Pōrero book. We're still just after Unit 2, the pronunciation section, if you are following along with the book at home. Now, if you're wanting to get your hands on this book, please get in touch with me at Tahia, T-A-A-H-I-A, at reorua.com, or you can contact me, of course, via our social pages, Reorua or Arrow FM. Obviously reference me or the show Kahurangi. We can get them from Tūmaira office at a cost. But of course, if you are just following with some notes and paper, ka pai tērā, we will get our quiz answers up at some point. I do apologise, I just haven't had time, unfortunately, coming out of our sickness and isolation, but those will go onto the social media pages, so if you're looking to answer the questions about pronunciation, awesome. The great thing about the Poetel book is it gives us a few maps with some place names of reference and of relevance to those of us who identify as being from here or calling Aotearoa home. So you'll see the national map, and then you'll see a regional rangitāne map of really important landscapes and place names here in our region in their original form. So before we arrive, because of the karakia, and then of course our lovely Hone Tūwhare poem that talks about the connection of sky to earth and ourselves to the spiritual world, and then followed by my beautiful father's voice singing about Papatūānuku, let's ground ourselves not just with maramataka today. It's been a while, so I'd like us to ground ourselves also with a kōrero about the arrival. And there are a number of these stories, so please bear in mind this is one of many and an interpretation of that story. Before we get into it, I'm going to share on page 182 of our Pūrākau book a story about Kura Marotini. And this is under chapter 7, Kupe. Kura Marotini by Briar Wood. So the story goes that trickster Kupe cheated his friend into diving overboard to free the lines, then paddled rapidly away. Somewha. Best to know that legendary navigators take huge risks and do not make the safest companions. Akuani, she asked herself. What do I want home in Hawaiki? All the travelling years. What does he want? The waka my father gifted? Matahourua and me? Or maybe unhappiness with the man she'd married drove her to the coast. It's possible. She was curious and hoturapa, wasn't the kind of man who liked a journey. So she chose Kupe. Yet even an inveterate traveller might become weary in a waka on the open sea, looking out for landfall, travelling direct to her destination. As the future loomed towards her, she named that radiant land on the horizon Aotearoa. E ai ki ngā kōrero o te wahine o Kupe, a Kura Marotini, a hine te aparangi rānei. He ao Aotearoa.
No ta fitsi no tata, no te whenua o te atua tātou. Aha ko anō hea mai koe, ka whawhai tonu mātou mō. Ko au tō maunga atu tonu, ko te moana pari mai koe. Ko koe te aua I takuremu, ko taua anō taua, no te ole I kurawa ka. Hei tiaki kaha tātou he mana tuku iho mai anō whenua haumako wairua ora whai ato ara ki te putunga
no te piti no tata no te whenua o te atua tātou aha ko anō hea mai koe ka whawhai tonu mātou mō he kore roto te whenua he te mai kia tātou. He toa au mōna e oke nei e. E kore au e hina, he uri no te roi mata. Te toto o la tūpuna. E kore au e wehi e.
Kia kaha tātou ki tau I pai e. Whakatinana kau au mutuna. Whenua haumako, wairua ora.
fai, kia toi tua ta fai, ma na pitsi a mai.
Aotearoa.
No ta pitsi no ta na.
No tawhiti, no tata, no te whenua o te atua tātou. And that's talking about whether we are near or far. No te whenua o te atua. We are all from this lovely land, ko Aotearoa. So we're going to continue that story now using Aorangi Tāne perspective from the Poet El book on page 24. Kupe me te whike o Muturangi. Kupe, a Polynesian voyager, was the first man, or one of, to discover the islands of Aotearoa, including Te Ika Māui. Similar to the story of Māui, Kupe's arrival laid the foundation for Māori to populate Aotearoa. Here is part of his story. Kupe was a great chief of Hawaiki and was one of the first great navigators and voyagers. One day, Kupe discovered that the pet octopus of Muturangi, along with other octopi, were causing havoc by destroying fundamental fishing lines and eating the fish at their recognised tauranga ika, fishing grounds, and the people were going hungry. Kupe, angered by this, declared, "I intend to slay te whike o Muturangi." Muturangi's pet octopus was over 18 feet long, therefore difficult for Kupe to capture and kill. So this wouldn't be an easy feat. Matahourua, Kupe's waka, was launched and Kupe with his family and fellow voyagers departed Hawaiki. After a time, they met up with Ngake. Ngake was well known to Kupe and is regarded by some Wellington iwi as a local taniwha. Kupe asked Ngake, "Have you seen Te Whike o Muturangi?" Ngake replied, "There, you can see him, reddening on the ripples of the sea." Kupe looked and it was so. They tried to approach the octopus together, but to no avail. The octopus only went on faster, directing their course toward the undiscovered islands of New Zealand. Kupe said to Ngake, "The octopus is headed for some land, apparently. By following it, we shall be led to a strange country." Not long after this, an island was seen in the far distance, like a cloud on the horizon. It is said that one of Kupe's wives, either Hine Te Aparangi or Kuramaro or Tini, devised the name Aotearoa, long white cloud, on seeing the North Island for the first time. With this visual, Ngake continued on in pursuit while Kupe went on from the North Cape to Hokianga and stayed a while. After a long stay at Hokianga, Kupe sailed after Ngake and found him at Rangi Whaka Oma Oma, Castle Point, waiting. Ngake informed Kupe that the octopus of Muturangi was there within a cave giving birth to offspring. Kupe proceeded to the cave and broke it open, which caused the octopus to flee in the night towards the south. Kupe and Ngake then gave chase and came to Te Kawakawa, Cape Palliser, the southern point of North Island. This name was given by Kupe because one of his daughters here made a wreath of kawakawa leaves, and the name has ever since remained in memory of it. They finally caught up with the giant octopus and started to battle. After a long, fierce battle, and with his axe, Rangitu Whenua, Kupe made a fierce downward blow, pawa, at the head of the monster octopus and smashed in its eyes. And so died this great sea creature, Te Whike o Muturangi. The above story explains why Kupe, Ngake, and their companions crossed the wider ocean and discovered Aotearoa. Reading through these important histories about our connections to this land and how we arrived here, you can now feel a stronger sense of connection to the names of the places around you. Now, in the book, we suggest that you use the supporting maps to practice stating place names aloud with correct pronunciation. And as we've just come out of the correct pronunciation workshop here on the show, I'm going to give you a couple of phrases and sentences that you might want to hold dear as a way of using the words within a sentence and saying it out loud with other words, so that you're, again, giving yourself more of a practice and chance to say things aloud. And while I do that, I'm just going to use the examples. I'm just holding it up to the screen for those who need to see it, of our New Zealand map to give you an idea of how you might do this. So the first sentence structure, tātouma, talks about from where we belong and from whom, because for some of us, a place is also a being or a tūpuna. And so there are two phrases that I want us to be mindful of, and they both use the same particle. They both sit within the sentence structure of nominal sentences or descriptive sentences. Excuse me. So these are patterns that we would use in language, often in personal introductions and in mihi, greetings. So the particle is nō with a macron. Nō hea koe would usually be the question, where are you from? Nō hea o tūpuna, from where or where are your ancestors from? So those are the two phrases for today. Nō hea koe, nō hea o tūpuna. So a macron on that O and tūpuna meaning ancestors. Some of us say tūpuna mātua, great ancestors. Yeah, edu edua, same, same. Nō hea koe, we would respond, nō place ahau. Nō place ahau. If we're answering the other question, where are our ancestors from? Nō place ōku tūpuna. Nō place ōku tūpuna mātua. Yeah. Now, if you're wanting to double up or triple up and you have a number that you want to list, the nō becomes a particle of use because it can be a spoken comma between places. Nō te whanganui a tara, nō wairarapa, nō rotorua ahau. Yeah. Nō hawaiki, nō ingarangi, ōku tūpuna. Kei te pai tātai? So here are some examples of just some kind of general sentences, and I'm just going to use some people that I know and some of the place names on this map. Now, going back to pronunciation revision, first syllable stress unless there's a macron. Of course, those of us who are native speakers or grew up as with te reo as a first language, we probably don't think about stress in te reo because it's a rhythmic oral language. But of course, if you're learning, put it at the beginning, so it changes that habit of putting it near the end, which is what we do in Latin languages, especially in English. The other thing we need to be mindful of is our spectrum, a, e, I, o, u. As we go from the beginning, a, e, they're quite open, sharp sounds, e biting down, starting to stretch, or u starting to close. Kei te pai? And in terms of the trickier consonants, ng, ng in the middle of the word in English, singing. Yeah, nice throat, subtle sound, we don't want to hear the G. Rolled R, if you can't do that, think of a soft D, like the double D in the word jadabar, or the udder of a cow. Ka pai tātou. And for most of us, the WH should be pronounced like an F for fish in English. Anei tātou. Nō hea koe. Nō te hokianga a kupe a Abby. Nō te hokianga a kupe a Abby. Abby is from te hokianga a kupe. Nō tāmaki makaurau a Amarita. Nō tāmaki makaurau a Amarita. Amarita is from tāmaki makaurau. So when we're speaking about another person, we have a little a in front of the named person. A Amarita, a Ebi. Nō hea o tūpuna. Nō te tūranga nui a kiwa o kutūpuna. My ancestors are from Te Turanga Nui a Kiwa. Nō hea o tūpuna. Nō tamaki nui arua o ku tūpuna. My tūpuna are from the Rangitāne Tamaki Nui Arua area. Nō hea koe. Nō te moana o Raukawa ahau. I am from the seas of Raukawa. Te moana o Raukawa speaks about the seas just under the most southern tip of the North Island. no hea o tūpuna, no whakaoriori o ku tūpuna. My ancestors are from Masterton. Yeah, so they're nice, handy phrases, and the maps are in there for reference. Of course, you might be living in another region or another area, trying to find those traditional or original, if you like, names are really important because they capture history and story and background and context. Now, I just want to whakakapi this kind of part of our pūrākau with a story, if you like, in waiata form. And this was written a few years ago in reference to the renaissance and revitalization of our iwi group, Rangitāne. No reira, I te timatanga o tēnei wahanga o kahurangi, i waiata tia e te rōpū o Rangiura i te waiata koeirarapa tēnei. He tino waiata tērā mō Ngāti Kahungunu, ki wairarapa no reira ko tāku nei he he whakamārama ki te hunga e whakarongo mai nei e ruanga iwi o konei. Ko Ngāti Kahungunu ki wairarapa tētahi, ko Rangitāne tētahi. A nei te waiata tū mai rā. Tēnā no tātou katoa. So we're just talking about the arrival of some of our early navigators, explorers, tohunga rangatira, he hano hoki, and Kupe was certainly one of them. Now, there are some iwi whānau hapū who truly believe that there were already people here when Kupe arrived, so it's really important that we note that. But we also note that we know that Maui was our discoverer of our islands. Now, he didn't stay here. He was washed back to Hawaiki in a number of the versions of the story. And so Kupe is usually associated with the discovery, if you like, of Māori, but it's important to note that for some Māori that is untrue. And there are different variations and diversities in the stories, and may we be really honourable in suggesting that there are a number of arrival stories. Whurangitāne, we call our region kind of as an umbrella term and expression, Tini Whetū. And according to that side of the story, and I want to acknowledge Matua Manahi Paiwai for this, is when our people arrived out of Kupe's original navigation and exploration and created pā and set up shop in different areas of the Wellington, Wairarapa, Manawatū areas. When they got to particularly a spot in Wellington on one of the hills, they couldn't see anyone else for miles. And they would turn around our ancestors and all they could see were stars, which is where our rangitāne phrase, Tini Whetū ki te rangi, ko rangitāne ki te whenua comes from. Tini Whetū is a way of talking about the multitude of stars. Ko rangitāne ki te whenua is an acknowledgement of the rangitāne people who were on the whenua. And the whenua at that point in time, where the whakatauākī was created, was actually in Wellington. So I suppose it's just my little sneaky note here that Wellington is also part of Rangitan, and we often forget that. And nei te kōrero mō kura haupō waka, part of our Pōrero book, page, where are we? Rua te kauma iwa. The Rangitāne story begins with the arrival of the kura haupō waka, canoe or migration. One of the principal chiefs aboard this waka was Whātonga. His descendants eventually migrated south from Mahia Peninsula to settle much of the lower North Island and the top of the South Island. The tribes associated with this waka include Rongomai Wahine in Mahia, Te Āti Haunui a Pāpārangi, Whanganui, Rangitāne, Manawatū, Tamaki Nui Ārua, Wairarapa and Wairau, Ngāti Apa in Rangitike and Marlborough regions, Muaupoko in Horowhenua, Ngai Tara in Wellington and Kapiti, Ngāti Kuia, Pelorus, and Ngāti Tū Matakōkiri in Golden Bay. Whātonga moved to what we know as the Hawke's Bay area and built a pā, which he named Here Taunga, which has remained, of course, as the name for Hastings. This later became the name adopted for the larger Hawke's Bay area. Oral tradition speaks of Whātonga embarking on a journey of discovery after displeasing his wife, Hotu Waipara. She had cut her hand on a nohu, a rock cod, that he had caught on a fishing venture. This incident led to their first son being named in remembrance of the event, Tara Ika, meaning fish spine. Whātonga's journey brought him to Wairarapa for the first time. He settled for some time at Rangi Whakaoma, Castle Point, where he built a pā called Matirie o Matira, which was situated where the current lighthouse, and I know those of you who are watching, we see our lovely lighthouse, so how beautiful, we have the visual reference here. They settled up where the current lighthouse still stands today. From here, he journeyed down to Te Whanganui Ātara, Wellington, up past Kapiti Island and Horowhenua before moving inland up the Manawatū River and Te Āpiti, our gorge. It was at this point that he first laid eyes upon a vast virgin forest that stretched beyond his view, filled with giant native trees. And I want to note here, I've just come from a lesson with Doc, and I want to acknowledge Robbie's kōrero, thank you. And reminding me, of course, Pūkaha Forest, that which remains of Te Tapere Nui o Whātonga, this vast forest, is actually older than the forest in Te Tararua o Ngā Tararua, the Tararua region. So may we just remember that when we're going in to visit up at Pūkaha Mount Bruce. It was of such splendour that he gave it his own name, Te Tapere Nui o Whātonga, or the Great Domain of Whātonga. It is from this once great forest that Pūkaha Mount Bruce remains as one of the last significant strands of native bush in this area. Whātonga had sons to two separate wives, and it was the descendants of these two half-brothers that eventually spread to occupy the lower North Island, Te Ukupoko o Te Ika a Maui, the head of the fish of Maui. The first-born son was Tara Ika, known more commonly as Tara, who gave rise to the tribe known as Ngai Tara, that lived for many centuries in the Wellington and West Coast area. Tara gave his name to the Wellington Harbour. It was actually named by his wife, Te Uma Roimata, which is known as Te Whanganui a Tara, or the Great Bay. His name is also commemorated in the Tararua Mountains that divide the Wellington region and is taken from the saying, Ngā waewae e rua a Tara, or the spanned legs of Tara, meaning that his people had a foothold on either side of these ranges. We all know this, of course, but again, our iwi have been re-establishing themselves in the last decade or so. The second son of Whātonga was Tautoki, born to Reretua. Tautoki gave birth to a son called Tāne Nui Ārangi, otherwise known as Rangitāne, and that's where we get our name, our common ancestor being Rangitāne. Not much is known about this great ancestor, although his progeny spread to cover a wide area. Rangitāne had two wives. His first, Mahue, bore a son called Kōpū Parapara. And it is from this ancestor that Hamua is derived. And Hamua is our largest hapu in this area, from which our kohangareo gets its name there on Cole Street. Nō reira tātou mā, using our two phrases, what I want you to work on for the week ahead as we move through our Pōreo course here on Arrow FM's Kahurangi Show with me, Te Atahia, your guide, is using our nō hea koe, nō hea o tūpuna, phrasing or sentence structure to maybe fill out some of these wonderful original names in your mihi on page 31. Now this is our Rangitane region, and of course the larger areas are not every natural feature, but some really recognisable names that I'd love for you to read and learn. Names like Te Apiti, Hamua, Rongomai, Eketahuna, Te Awhānui, Whakaoriori, Taratahi, Hupenui, Paitu Mokai, and so on. Yeah. Now, if you are not from here, your ancestors are not from here, another phrase you can turn to is Kei hea tō kāinga. Where is your home? Kei hea tō kāinga. And of course, you'd replace the hea. The kei at the beginning remains our particle. Kei into place tō ku kāinga would be your answer. So give that a go, tātou mā. And I'm just going to wrap up by finishing from our Pūrākau book, and we'll come back and do some wonderful pānui very soon. But we have this lovely poem in our Pūrākau book called Waka. And you'll find this at the very end in our, what they call the epilogue, the future, which is on page 99. And this is by Robert Sullivan, just as a way to whakakapi, to maybe conclude and summarise some of the themes from our kōrero today. Nō reira, tātou mā whakarongo mai nei. If waka could be resurrected, they wouldn't just come out from museum doors smashing, glass cases revolving and sliding, doors on their exit. They wouldn't just come out of mountains as if liquidified from a frozen state. The resurrection wouldn't just come about this way. The South Island turned to wood, waiting for the giant crew of Maui and his brothers. Bailers and anchors turned back to what they were when they were strewn about the country, strewn about the country by Kupe and his relations. The resurrection would happen in the blood of the men and women, the boys and girls who are blood relations of the crews whose veins touch the veins who touched the veins of those who touched the veins, who touched the veins, who touched the veins of the men and women from the time of Kupe and before. The resurrection will come out of their blood. And that was Waka 99 by Robert Sullivan.
Hãy subscribe.
ko tērā te waiata ko whiti ora na Maisi Rika, Magic Paora. Mo e rātū tāngata rongonui rawa atu ki te waiata ki te whakatangitangi puoro hoki. Just as that song is wonderfully kind of summarising a lot of the themes of today's pūrākau and our ability to put phrase to kōrero, to pūrākau, to history and connection, I just wanted to bring in some papānui before finishing up and concluding with another karakia. So between Monday the 23rd and May to this Saturday 11th of June, and I'm holding it up, if you see these pānui around the place, why did I a Spinners and Weavers Guild annual shop have some winter woolies and handmade treasures. And how wonderful thinking about sourcing local, especially at this time, you know, we're really mindful of the cost of things and of the disruption to movement of goods, and so why not look local? On Queen Street, so next to Milady and opposite the Master and District Council offices, you'll see this wonderful shop open 9 to 5 on weekdays and 9:30 to 1 on Saturdays. Please go and check them out, get your winter woolies sorted and maybe some gifts for this winter period. On the 16th, which is next Monday, Pepe Ora are running a beautiful and important kōrero and workshop for anyone interested, but those particularly in the health, well-being or whānau parenting space on safe sleep. Now, this was supposed to be last year for Safe Sleep Day and it has been postponed. So on Monday the 16th from 9 till 3, get in touch with Linda or Sarah at Pepe Ora for more information. And it's going to be being run out of Haukainga here in Masterton, a wonderful space where you will come and learn about parenting traditions from Te Ao Māori. I'm going to be running that. You'll be learning how to put a muka pito tai together with our lovely Chloe from Ōhua, and there will be some wonderful discussions around baby's first food. So if you are working with children, with young babies, with new whānau communities here, and you're wanting to know a little bit more around traditional practices and kōrero, come along to that and get some information from Pepe Ora. Then on Tuesday the 17th of May, which is why I said REAP, Waited Up, I have put together an incredible opportunity for any of us needing to connect in with some tools and some support around grief. So I want to acknowledge my Queenie Kerehi here, who has put together Ka Pō, Ka Ao, Ka Awatea, a workshop to learn some strategies between 6 and 9 p.m. on Tuesday the 17th of May. If you're wanting some more information, contact REAP Waited Up about signing up and registering for that. We will have a wonderful grief counsellor come in and have that kōrero and host us, and I will be sharing some maramataka insights to, again, fill up our kete with some tools and skills. Last but not least, I'm going to finish off with a karakia very soon to wind us up, but I just wanted to acknowledge you would have heard some of my waiata whakakapi and kinaki throughout the show. Pauline Harter, our wonderful, wonderful kahurangi, who is sitting as the head of the Montessori Preschool on Lincoln Road here in Masterton and works down at the South End Montessori Primary School. Pauline, the lovely teacher who guides my children and nurtures them when I'm not and when I'm working elsewhere. I just want to say he mihi tēnei, he mihi aroha tēnei ki a koe te rangatira, me o mahi rangatira. She's really hardworking, dedicated and absolutely stunning as a singer, as a voice, a strength, a supporter of Te Ao Māori, an ally. And she's been sending me these wonderful waiata that she sings with her children, wanting to put them into Te Reo Māori. So those are the songs you've been hearing. This last one I haven't gotten to yet, but I'm going to just read them out because I think they summarise a lot of our kōrero for today. So I'll go from this and then into our karakia. The river, it is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, it is flowing down to the sea. Flow, river, carry me, a child I shall always be. Flow, river, carry me down to the sea. Whakairi ake te ke te kōrero ki te pū tuārongo. Hei tiki anō mō muri ake nei. Kia wātea ai, kia wātea ai. Kia tīnā, haumi e, hui e, tae ki e. Hei waiata whakakapi mā tātou, kwau tēnei ko te atahi ai waiata nei te waiata o Rahera Davies Matariki. Matariki, matariki, e ara e. te mātahi o te tau, te kohinga whetū i te māo. Rangi nui, e piatata mai ana, whakatata i te rangi. E tohu ana i te tau hou Māori e. No reira, tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou, kia ora anō tātou katoa.